Catherine Teagan and Harper Audio present The Supervillain's Guide to Being a Fat Kid by Matt Wallace, performed by Mark Sanderlin. Prologue. What would Master Plan do? Max shouldn't have been thinking about revenge, about taking down Johnny Preparzi once and for all. Max shouldn't have been thinking about how good it would feel to throw him through the nearest window. The boy the whole school called Johnny Pro had already gotten what he deserved for making Max's life miserable. At least, that's what Max told himself. But to have Johnny Pro physically feel just a little of what he'd made Max feel since the school year began, what other kids like him had made Max feel for as long as Max could remember, that was so tempting. He knew he could do it. He had the training now. Max should have been thinking instead about finishing the plan, about putting the last piece in the puzzle, like his friend, teacher, and mentor told him he could do at this party. Revenge wasn't part of that plan. That should have been at the front of Max's brain, but all Max could think about was how uncomfortable the suit he was wearing made him. Master Plan said he'd get used to it. He told Max that it was like anything we do to help us become the people we want to be. Those things can be uncomfortable at first. They can even hurt, but it is the kind of hurt that's like a broken bone healing. In the end, it makes you stronger. Most kids in the sixth grade didn't wear suits to school, at least not to his school. He'd told Master Plan that he'd get killed wearing one to class. But this was a party. It was only the second time he'd ever worn one. The first was at his first communion ceremony, and it was this itchy brown thing his mother bought at a secondhand shop that was too small. He remembered he could barely keep the shirt tucked inside the pants. The suit Master Plan had ordered for Max, made just to fit him, was like wearing a cloud compared to that other one, but it was still more than he was used to. Master Plan told him it was the last step in changing the way the other kids thought of him. Max did think the suit looked cool. He just didn't like it because it made him sweat. Everything made him sweat, but wearing layers of clothes always made it worse. Max watched half the Captain Clobbertime Memorial Middle School water polo team striding toward him, danger in their every step and fury in their eyes, led by the eighth grade boy whose downfall Max had directly caused. He wondered if he was sweating more because of the extra clothes or because of how nervous he felt about what was about to happen. Max had learned a lot since he opened his first email from Master Plan, but the biggest thing he'd learned was that there are things people do and say that they can never take back. There are some things that saying sorry for isn't enough. Those things change people and the world around them forever. You had to decide if doing them would change your world for the better, and if making that happen was worth it to you. Master Plan was the one who had taught Max what consequence meant, and more than that, what it could do to people. That's how Max knew that what he had done to Johnny Pro was one of those things you couldn't take back. As he watched the boy, the one who'd made him afraid just to exist, about to step to him, Max knew at once that if he let Johnny Pro provoke Max into acting, something else would happen that he couldn't take back. The world around him would change, and whether that change was good for Max, it would definitely be bad for the other boys. A big part of him wanted that to happen. He still wasn't sure, though. Master Plan wouldn't wait. Max knew that. He wouldn't ask himself questions. He wouldn't be sweating through two shirts. Master Plan would have already decided to wreck them all if they were coming after him. But Max wasn't Master Plan. Yet. A second ago, he didn't think he could sweat any more or any harder. But he was wrong. Lower class. Max yawned until his jaw hurt. He could never sleep the night before the first day of school, and last night had been even worse. It was probably because he was starting at an entirely new school the next day, his first day as a sixth grader. He'd been among the biggest and oldest kids in elementary the year before, and now he was the youngest. He was far from the smallest, but being big had never seemed to help him. It was the opposite, in fact. He'd stayed up most of the night watching the same movie over and over again. Waitress, the one about the girl who bakes different pies and names them after all the problems she's having in her life. Those problems were a lot more adult than anything Max had dealt with, but he still liked the idea, and he loved the pie recipes. He'd made his own versions of all of them at home. He wished he were in his kitchen now. At least he had Luca. The two of them were posted up outside on a cement bench in the quad of Captain Clobbertime Memorial Middle School, waiting for the first bell. Max always felt weird thinking of Luca as his best friend, partly because Luca was his only friend, and partly because Luca had never said Max was his best friend. It also might have been because neither of them had really decided to hang out. They sort of just fell together a few years ago. In elementary school, kids made fun of Luca for wearing the same clothes almost every day, and they didn't always smell great. The same kids made fun of Max for being fat. They started eating lunch together because they were the only ones who didn't make fun of them.
"Did you hear about Cobalt?" Luca asked him.
"No, what about him?"
"I don't know, I was asking you. They were saying something about him on the news when my mom dropped me off. It sounded like a big deal."
"Probably got another medal or blew up another building or satellite or something, and they have to pretend it wasn't an accident."
"Dude, that happened like one time. Why do you always talk smack about him for that? Cobalt's the coolest."
Max ignored the question. He usually did when the subject of superheroes came up. He was also distracted, though. There was a girl across the quad who looked to be their age, giving out cookies from a plastic container. She was just sort of handing them out to what looked like random sixth graders, smiling and laughing. Her smile was nice. Her laugh, too. Neither seemed fake to Max. She was pretty, but it was the cookies that interested him. He wondered if she baked them herself. He didn't know any other kids who baked.
"Do you know her?"
Max asked Luca.
"Who?"
Max didn't want to point, so he leaned his head in the girl's direction. "With the cookies," he said. Luca looked over at her without even trying to be sneaky about it.
"Dude!" Max barked.
He looked from the girl to Max, blinking.
"What?"
Max just shook his head. "Did she go to our old school?" Luca shrugged.
"Maybe, like in another class? I don't know."
"You think she made those cookies herself?"
"How would I know? Maybe. Why?"
"I don't know, they look good."
"They look good, or she looks good?"
"Shut up, dude, I'm not being gross. I just was."
"You should go ask her if you're so curious. You bake too, you could talk about it. We said middle school was gonna be different for us, right? Talking to a girl the first day would be different."
Max thought that sounded terrifying and impossible, not different. He realized the girl was getting closer and closer to where he and Luca were sitting. Max's heart started beating fast.
"What is wrong with you, man?" Luca asked, staring at him like Max was slowly transforming into a large bug or something.
"What? Nothing." The next thing Max knew, he was staring into the girl's open plastic container of cookies, and she was looking down at them on the bench.
"Hey, you guys went to Glow Girl Elementary, right?"
Max didn't say anything. Fortunately, out of the corner of his eye, he saw Luca nodding. The girl nodded.
"Yeah, I remember seeing you at recess. Here, I made cookies for everybody. I figured we all need it, you know?"
That's a cool thing to do, Max managed to say.
Can I take two? Luca asked. I missed breakfast.
Sure, you both can if you want.
Luca quickly grabbed four cookies, handing two to Max.
See you in class, maybe?
The girl said to them, her eyes meeting Max's for a second before she walked away. Max crammed most of the first cookie into his mouth. It tasted amazing. There were chocolate and peanut butter chips, and what he thought were vanilla chips.
These cookies rule,
Luca mumbled with his mouth also full.
You should definitely get her recipe and make these.
Max only nodded. He still had his mouth full of half-chewed cookie, crumbs covering his cheeks and the front of his shirt like grains of sand, when several long shadows fell over him and Luca. They were older boys, maybe even eighth graders. The three of them were wearing the same Capes jacket. The Capes were the school sports team name. They did not look like they wanted to give Max and Luca free cookies. Max knew right away and from experience that the tallest one standing in the middle of them was going to be the biggest problem. He had that look on his face. Max knew that look. While the other boys barely seemed to even see Max and Luca, the tall one was staring right at Max, like nothing in the world except Max even existed. His eyes were full of something that wasn't totally anger or menace, although there was plenty of both there. It was more like disgust, though, like whatever he was looking at was the grossest thing he'd ever seen.
You're getting crumbs all over my bench, he said to Max.
How's it your bench? Luca asked.
Those mad, disgusted eyes snapped to Luca for just a second.
Shut up, thrift store. Nobody's talking to you.
The leader looked back at Max, as if he was waiting for Max to say something. Max tried to chew faster so he could swallow the cookie in his mouth, but that only seemed to make the other boy angrier.
God, you look like a cow when you do that. Stop it.
Max stopped chewing.
Can you even talk? The boy demanded.
His mouth's full and you told him to stop chewing, Luca pointed out, only for one of the boy's teammates to reach down and flick Luca in the face with his fingers.
I said shut up,
the tall one who was doing all the talking yelled at him. Luca dropped his gaze to the ground.
I asked you a question, the eighth grader said to Max.
Max didn't know what to do, so he did nothing. That was the wrong choice, apparently. The tallest one reached down and grabbed Max in a headlock, holding his neck tightly with one arm and pulling Max from the bench. Max lost his balance and fell to his knees. The older boy dropped to the ground with him, keeping a hold of Max and pulling up Max's shirt over his belly. He started slapping him in the stomach as if he were using Max's belly to clap. Max spit chewed up cookie all over the grass as he cried out and struggled just to breathe. The other boy was strong. It was impossible to break free. Max could see Luca trying to help him, but the older boy's teammates kept pushing him down against the cement bench. Max shut his eyes tight. It wasn't getting his belly slapped, although that stung mightily. It wasn't even that he had to gasp to breathe. He just didn't want to see everyone who was watching this happen. That was always the worst part. When it was over and the eighth grader let him go, Max realized he'd started crying without even knowing it. Max heard laughing. He didn't want to, but he opened his eyes. A big crowd had gathered, mostly upper-class kids. Through his teary eyes, he didn't see a face that wasn't grinning or smiling, like this was the funniest thing they'd ever seen. Then they started chanting like they were at a sports game, cheering for their favorite player.
Johnny Pro! Johnny Pro! Johnny Pro!
What the heck is a Johnny Pro?
The boy who had just wrestled him to the ground stood over Max and raised his arms in the air like a rock star.
He must be Johnny Pro, Max thought.
The eighth graders were gone by the time a teacher, a ferret-faced little man with a mustache and wearing a whistle around his neck, pushed his way through the crowd to find Max barely...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.